my honor to welcome Taesub Kum to the University of Oregon, along with Kelly Che. Representative Kum is Congressman for the 20th National Assembly of the Republic of Korea, and we're really honored to have Representative Kum here. I'm the director of the Center for Asian and Pacific Studies and a professor of history, Japanese history. And I want to welcome Representative Kum on behalf of the Myungsup Lim lecture series in Korean studies. And I want to just say a little bit about that, not very much at all. This is a lecture series that is sponsored by a very generous gift from Ji-Yoon Lim, who is the president of a company in Seoul called Optron Tech. He gave this money in honor of his father, who was the founder of the company and also a great supporter of his and his sister's education. There are a number of different sponsors for this, including the Center for Asian and Pacific Studies, but also the School of Journalism and Communications, the Asian Studies Program, the Office of International Affairs, and the Jonathan Marshall First Amendment Chair in the School of Journalism and Communications. I'll just be really brief here and introduce a member of who was original member of my shadow cabinet in the Center for Asian and Pacific Studies, Kyu Ho Yum, who is the Jonathan Marshall Chair of First Amendment Studies in the School of Journalism and Communications, and he will be the one to introduce Representative Kyu.
So good afternoon. I'm so delighted, you know, to have you all for a representative Taesub Kum's invited lecture. As already, you know, Dr. Jeff Haynes mentioned, this is one of the signature events relating to the CAPS, Center for Asia Pacific Studies. And I have been associated with the CAPS as a member, not necessarily as a member of the CAPS shadow cabinet. He's a little bit overstating his case. But in my case, you know, I was involved, especially in this case, you know, represent him. Just one personal footnote. On November 22nd of 2011, I enjoyed reading Representative Kum's, at the time he was an attorney in South Korea. He wrote a lengthy piece about a particular issue of Korean law, which has been some kind of very interesting to me as an American media law scholar. His Facebook comment was about the insult law. It was some kind of crime to insult people in South Korea. I was so impressed. That's why I wrote a private message to Attorney Kum via Facebook. Dear, you know, Mr. Kum, I really enjoyed your Facebook comment about the insult law, and I hope, you know, I will read more, and I hope I will see you sometime in the future. This is why we are here now. And let me give you some background about him and why he's worth your time, and also why he's worth our time collectively. He is no question a rising star in the National Assembly of South Korea. And he was an up-and-coming prosecutor in South Korea in the mid-2000s. He wrote a column for one of the rather liberal newspapers called Hangyore. And his column was about how to protect, essentially, how the accused can protect themselves when they are summoned or when they are subpoenaed. It was a kind of important constitutional rights of the accused. In the United States, it's very much a part of the Sixth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. When he wrote the column, he definitely put his superiors, I am talking about Supreme Prosecutor's Office, on the spot. He was essentially, you know, paid a high price. He was forced out of office. He was, no question, a prosecutor standing up for the ordinary people. He was a courageous prosecutor. And that is why we have him here now as a politician, rather than as the, you know, supreme prosecutor of South Korea, more or less. And he was a lawyer. But before becoming a lawyer, he was a prosecutor for 12 years. After leaving the prosecuting career, he worked as a lawyer for 10 years. Then he was more or less a celebrity. He was a broadcaster, and he was a columnist. And then he was, not surprisingly, recruited by a major political party in South Korea. He worked as the spokesperson for the political party, and also he was involved as an advisor to the mayoral election of current Seoul mayor Park Won-sun. And now he is a member of the 20th Korean National Assembly. He is very actively involved in proposing very important legislation. And that is why he received several awards for the most distinguished legislator from the National Assembly. And so he's setting the agenda. Instead of just counting how much time he's spending outside the National Assembly, and that is making a huge difference. And also, most relevant to today's topic, I say law, politics, and the impeachment in South Korea, President Park Geun-hye's case in comparative perspective. He will talk about his real-life experience about the process of impeaching the former President Park Geun-hye. He was directly involved in writing the bill of impeachment. So he has a lot of interesting stories to share with you. And there is a lot of interesting perspectives for him to share with me. And without further ado, I'd like to ask you to join me in welcoming the Honorable Tae-seok Kim from South Korea.
Thank you. Thank you very much for extremely kind introduction. And thank you for taking your time to be here today with me. It is really an honor for me to be here and speak to you. My name is Tae-seok Kim. I'm a member of Korean National Assembly. Before I became a politician, I had worked as a prosecutor for 12 years and a lawyer for 10 years. Today, I'm going to speak about our experience of impeachment. Korea impeached the president in 2017. In recent years, there have been many democratization movements around the world, but there are very few successful cases. So I would like to explain how we accomplished peaceful power transition successfully. As a politician, I witnessed the history of impeachment at the heart. Personally, I drafted the impeachment bill myself. And during the candlelight protest, I met my son face to face more than once. My son was serving his military duty as a riot policeman. So he was on the street squashing the protest, and I was on the street to protest. It was like a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Impeachment is not a riot. It's not illegal. It's a fruit from a well-established political and judicial system. I will focus on what elements were essential to enable the successful impeachment. There are many ways to topple your government. If I tell you about Korea's experience. Since 1945, when we became independent from Japan, we have held almost all the possible ways of overturning the government. We have seen a revolution. This was in 1960. And we have had two military coups. This was in 1961. This was in 1980. And we have seen an assassination of the president. This was in 1979. Of course, we have seen peaceful power transition. And finally, last year, we witnessed the impeachment. In the constitutional context, I have to admit that impeachment is a crisis. We ousted the president who had been elected democratically. And by its nature, impeachment means that we had chosen a very wrong person for the head of our country. But sometimes you have to do what you have to do. And when you do that, you have to do it right. If such occasion arises, I can assure you that the impeachment is the least bad choice. Let's see what really happened in Korea during the impeachment. Let's watch a short video clip. As you can see, candlelight filled up the street. Millions of people came out voluntarily and shouted, "President Park should be impeached." Now I would like to share an interesting research. An American political scientist, Erica Chenoweth, introduced 3.5% rule. According to the rule, it only takes 3.5% of the population to topple a dictator. No government could survive when 3.5% of its people mobilize themselves non-violently. In the US today, this means 11 million people. So if you want to impeach your president, you need only 11 million people. For Korea, the magic number was 1.8 million. And according to you saw the video, can you guess how many Koreans participated in the candlelight protest? 17 million. It was 17 million. And we have only 51 million people. One third of the Koreans, regardless of age, gender, class, supporting political party, level of education, came out to call for President Park's resignation. Professor Chenoweth also stressed that non-violent resistance has been the quickest, the least expensive, and the safest way to bring down a wrong government. The candlelight protest in Korea took place on every Saturday for 21 weeks, almost for 5 months. But I must say this proudly, we did not have a single violent incident or crash. Let me tell you about my son. This is my son. In Korea, males are obliged to serve in military for at least 21 months. As I briefly mentioned, my son was in the army as a riot policeman. His main duty with his colleagues was bring peace for violent situations. But in the past, the riot policemen themselves had been very violent, and so were some demonstrations. Let's watch another clip. This was 1.5 years before the impeachment. 1.5 years before the impeachment, there had been a tragic incident. During a street protest, a farmer named Bang Nam-gi was aimed at directly with high-powered water spout and died. Because of his tragic death, there were fierce protests and even more brutal reactions from the government side. We did not want such situations to happen during the impeachment phase. Violence from one side must bring violence from the other side. If people get violent, President Park's government would have shown equivalent or worse reactions. That must have brought total chaos. We did not want that. So Koreans strongly urged each other not to get violent. This is early stage of candlelight protest. At the early stage, some people tried to climb up the police buses or even tried to overturn them. Some people even tried to attack policemen. Whenever that happened, people around them shouted, "No violence." Once protests became settled to be totally peaceful, the riot police could not use violence. I remember when I met my son during the demonstration. He was there to serve his military duty, and I was there to do my part, to stand at the front to protest. We looked at each other, and I couldn't help having a mixed feeling. But we both knew that there would be no violence. He would be safe, and we would be safe. That way, so many people could participate in protest freely. And that was one of the main reasons why we could succeed. We kept nonviolence for 5 months. We held all the candlelight protests peacefully. People felt they were safe during the full impeachment, and they trusted that even after the impeachment, they would be safe. Now I would like to talk about freedom of speech. The request for impeachment starts with people. People should be able to express their opinions without troubles. Many countries often have difficulties in building a democratic government because of their limited freedom of expression. I will talk about situation in Korea. Korea has both bright and dark side. Article 21 of our constitution provides that all citizens shall enjoy freedom of speech and the press, and freedom of assembly and association. This is just like your First Amendment. But for Koreans, the rights were not fully enjoyed as they were written. The freedom of expression laws have been amended over decades to work it right. For instance, in Korea, to have a night rally, a protest before a sunset, after a sunset, or before a sunrise, had been banned. But in 2014, the Constitutional Court ruled that the laws limited people's fundamental rights too much. So those laws were against the Constitution. The court struck down those laws. So, as you know, we could have candlelight protest at night during the impeachment. However, in terms of freedom of speech, we have a long way to go. In Korea, there is this one big problem: defamation law. Korea's defamation law is very strict. This is Korean Act on Information and Communication. It provides that a person who commits defamation of another person by disclosing a fact shall be punished by imprisonment for up to 3 years. And a person who commits defamation of another person by disclosing a false fact shall be punished by imprisonment for up to 7 years. In Korea, defamation is a crime. People can be put into prison up to 3 years for comments that are true, and up to 7 years for comments that are false. Let's see an example. This is President Trump's tweet. An extremely credible source has called my office and told me that Barack Obama's birth certificate is a fraud. Considering this accusation was false, under the Korea's current defamation law, President Trump can be found guilty and sentenced maximum 7 years of imprisonment. Even if this accusation were true, he could still be put into a prison up to 3 years. Now, some of you may consider this as fulfillment of justice, but problem is that the law per se intimidates people's freedom of speech. Some critics say the law is very vague, and there are many ways to abuse the freedom of expression. Park's government overused the defamation law to silence its critics. And prosecutors did not seem to care whether they win or not, because all they wanted was to give people the chilling effect. Ordinary people flinch at the thought of possible criminal prosecution. Actually, the government oftentimes lost their cases in the court, but they did not care. Freedom of House criticized the increased intimidation of political opponents under Park's government. This is one example. A citizen who distributed this printed poster, a satire of President Park, was arrested in 2015. Going to jail because of a satire poster, that cannot be good. There is another downside of this defamation law. Under the Korea's defamation law, if you do not sue or bring charge, it gives an implication that the original allegation was true. So unfortunately, now not just the conservative side, but also liberal side has become to use the defamation law to make a point. I myself proposed the motion to decriminalize the defamation, but it has not passed in the National Assembly yet. Until now, we talked about candlelight protests and the freedom of expression. Now, political alternatives. Korea has a stable institution based on concrete checks and balances. And we have a political alternative. Many Arabic countries that failed to, in Arab Spring, many Arabic countries that failed to bring democracy did not have very strong opposition parties. For instance, when Saddam Hussein was ousted, the whole political system of Iraq broke down, because Iraq by then was de facto one-party system. Ba'ath was the only party. No president often means indicates a void of government there, and this leads to a political mayhem. However, in Korea, we have established a strong multi-party system. There are two strong political parties with more than 100 congressmen each. It's just like you have Democratic Party and Republican Party in USA. That means we always have an alternative. When the Conservative Party's leadership failed, or the Liberal Party's leadership failed, the other party can replace it. That's why in Korea, it is unlikely for the military or other non-political groups to occupy the power. Now let's look at the legal aspect of the impeachment process. Under the Constitution of Korea, the impeachment starts with the National Assembly and it is decided by the Constitutional Court. If there's only people's movement, it can hardly end up successfully. The formal institutions should recognize, deliver, and reflect people's will lawfully. The Korean procedure for impeachment is set out in our constitution. We are unicameral. We have only one assembly. If the president violates the constitution or other laws, the National Assembly can issue the motion for the impeachment. The impeachment bill must be proposed by the majority of the National Assembly member and approved by two-thirds to be passed. There are 300 members of Congress total. When the National Assembly passes the impeachment bill, it goes to the Constitutional Court. Then the impeachment trial will be held in the Constitutional Court. But to pass the impeachment bill, we need an actual impeachment bill. Back then, there were so many discussions, so many talks. Everybody just talked. But somebody actually had to sit down and write down the bill. I volunteered to be that somebody. And this is my office, and this is the impeachment bill. I composed the bill with two parts. First one is the violation of the Constitution. At the heart of all the impeachment drama lies a close friendship between President Park and one Ms. Choi. This is a mysterious woman. By the principle of popular sovereignty, the elected president had to exercise her power and authority for herself. However, Park delegated her power to her friend Choi unlawfully. Choi hasn't had any experience as a government officer. She did not have any qualifications to govern a country. She even did not have a college diploma. Officially, she was nobody. But Choi secretly drafted and reviewed important presidential speeches and documents. She decided who would be the member of the cabinet. She recommended top level of government officials. She even had an influence on the diplomacy. Of course, she was behind the curtain. We did not know then. Later, President Park said, Ms. Choi was such a talented speechwriter that she took her advice sometimes. But the investigation revealed that Choi's influence couldn't be any greater and broader. We still wonder why President Park asked assistance from Ms. Choi, not from her staffs in the Blue House, the Korean presidential office. They were much more qualified. We still don't know. Some people try to trace back to the close relationship between Park and Ms. Choi's late father. He was a spiritual leader. Park's relationship with Choi's father has long been controversial in Korea. Some said it was a romantic one, but we don't have any clear evidence to back it up. And even if the rumor was true, of course, it cannot be acceptable for Park to delegate her power to Choi. To conceal the secret of unlawful power delegation, Park was very reluctant to share her whereabouts to her staff. In times of national crisis or disasters, even the chief of staff wasn't informed of Park's locations. Nobody knows where the president is. That's how the situation was under Park's regime. You all know where George W. Bush was when 9/11 happened. But we still don't know where President Park was when we had certain crises. That is unlawful delegation of president authorities. It is against the Constitution. So I identified this as the first ground for Park to be impeached. Second part was her criminal offenses. Park abused her power and extorted companies to pay her tens of millions of dollars as bribe. Park also leaked confidential classified information to Choi. After some discussion in our party, the bill of impeachment was submitted. As I said earlier, we need 200 votes among 300 congressmen to start the impeachment. The sum of opposition parties' congressmen by then was only 172. We were short of 28. We needed at least 28 more congressmen from the ruling Conservative Party. By then, people's will to remove Park was so strong and intense. If the National Assembly failed to pass the impeachment bill, we might have had violent upheavals. To prevent such incidents, congressmen from our party, Democratic Party, appealed, even implored, to the ruling party members to vote for the bill. During the this is our National Assembly building. During the voting, tens of thousands of Koreans surrounded and protested outside National Assembly building. Main meeting room is there. I was there, and these are people protesting, and my son was here. We could actually hear them shouting. The Secretariat of National Assembly prepared a contingency plan to shutting down the buildings in case of failing to pass the bill. We had expected furious people to break into the buildings. If such thing had happened, Korea probably would have written a totally different version of history, and I wouldn't be here to hold this lecture. The impeachment vote took place on December 9 in 2016. 234 members of the among 300 members voted in favor of the impeachment. At least 62 members from the ruling party voted for the impeachment. Now the case goes to the Constitutional Court. At this point, I would like to talk a little bit about judicial activism. As you, some of you well know, there are two mainstream judicial philosophies to define and interpret the role of judiciary: judicial activism and judicial minimalism. Judicial minimalism refers to a philosophy which detaches the judiciary from the executives and legislatives. It minimizes the role of judiciary branch. On the other hand, judicial activism is a philosophy that favors proactive judicial rulings. Especially under an oppressive authority, judicial activism believes that the court needs to step in to stand against tyranny. Brave judges tried to protect citizens' freedom under dictatorship. I want to share my personal anecdote. This is my father. My passed away father was a judge. Jung Hee Bak, the father of the impeached President Geun Hye Bak, was by then the president. He was more like a dictator. He ruled Korea for 18 long years. Later, he was assassinated by none other than the director of his secret service. Anyway, under Jung Hee Bak's regime, my father exonerated students who had been arrested for involving in protest. Eventually, my father had to quit his job and leave the court. Korea has undergone such occasions during democratization. Therefore, Korean people tend to give more credit to judicial activism and have asked the court to be proactive, especially when government is autocratic. For impeachment, the Constitutional Court justices also actively adhered to the idea of judicial activism. Yes. This is the judgment day. She's the acting Chief Justice of Constitutional Court, Jung Mi-ri. 들어보세요.
네. 오입하고 있다. 재판관들의 현재 구매와 역사를 대응하는 마음을 얼마나
Can you see those pink rollers? They are hair rollers. On that day, she was so nervous and forgot to take them off. We adore this picture. She became a symbol of working woman. But this shows how imminent and grave the situation was. The court upheld the impeachment in a unanimous 8-0 decision on March 10th in 2017. Since we had had a conservative government for 10 years by then, most justices had been appointed by conservative president. So if the justices had wanted to avoid the impeachment, all they had to do was protract the case, protract the trial, but they did not. Even the conservative justices stepped up following the long tradition of the judicial activism. The court ruled that the negative impact of the president's legal violation is serious, and the benefits to defending the Constitution by dismissing her from office are outstandingly large. The court also concluded that the president had helped a friend, Ms. Choi, to extract bribe from Korean conglomerates like Samsung. This is CEO of Samsung, by personally asking big donations. During the trial, President Park remained silent, and the court chastised her for that too, for a lack of sense of responsibility. It was the first time that a sitting president was removed from the office after our country became democratic in 1987. It was a political tragedy to remove the head of the state who had been democratically elected by our hands. But however, it was the right action to do. We restored damaged democracy, and we rebuilt public trust on our government. To wrap up the lecture, there are four key elements of Korea's peaceful solution. First, people's power, nonviolent protest by 17 million Koreans for 5 months. Second, freedom of expression. Third, the existence of political alternatives. Fourth, stable institution based on check and balance and judicial activism. After the impeachment, we elected the new president, President Moon Jae-in. This is president and this is me. He is playing a very important role to ensure successful summit meeting between South and North Korea and US and North Korea. We are very proud to witness a new chapter of the history. I want to finish the lecture by citing the quote by John Marshall, former Chief Justice of the United States. The people made the Constitution, and the people can unmake it. It is the creature of their own will and lives only by their will. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Alec Murphy. I'm a geography professor here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I was particularly interested by your discussion of the defamation law. Mm-hmm. And under American defamation law, there's a difference between the way public figures and mm-hmm. private figures are treated. I wonder if there's any kind of similar distinction made in Korean law, or if this is one of the areas where there's consideration of making a distinction.
Yes, we have a defense for defamation. So if the allegation comment is true, and if the comment was said only for public interest, there can be a defense. One can have a defense. And in case of public figure, it is easier to 인정받다가 뭐지? The court can acknowledge easily the public interest. So there is a distinction between ordinary people and public figure. Yes. Please.
I got to personally experience, you know, the impeachment while being in Korea. And even after the impeachment was taken place internationally, I think Korea was praised for just how it executed the impeachment and just to demonstrate democracy. With that being said, what do you think were some obstacles or like that helped this peaceful impeachment to be executed?
We have a tradition of peaceful protest. But sometimes people got violent, and they developed some fighting skills. Like people used bamboo stick, split end. So they poke the riot policeman with the bamboo stick, and it can go through the net of their helmets. The riot policemen can hurt their eyes, but people many people don't like such things. And so if such things happens, we thought that we cannot have a lot of people on demonstration. So we urged people not to do such things. And so at first, only usual suspects came to the square. But they took their pictures and posted on Facebook and Twitter like that. And people realized that it was very safe. And some people came out with their children, babies, and their pictures were posted on in Facebook. That way, a lot of people came to the square. Yes.
It has been said, it has been said, and I have heard it said by many in Korea, including President Moon, that the fundamental problem in Korea has been the constitution of Korea, which allows too much power concentrated in the office of the president. Mm-hmm. That's why so many presidents have ended up in the prison. I know there is currently a lot of talk about the constitutional change. Mm-hmm. I have heard nothing from your party and President Moon about the need to change that in the new constitution. I'd like to hear your view about that.
Well, I couldn't agree more. Almost all our president went to jail or commit suicide, and so we know that not only the people, not only the president are problem. Our constitution has a serious problem, and the thing is, as you said, it gives too much power to the president, and so we are trying to amend our constitution, not just add something to the constitution. We are trying to reform the constitution on the whole. But we need, like impeachment, we need 200 votes at the National Assembly. And the opposition party doesn't want to amend the constitution. So it is kind of stuck now, but we really want to amend our constitution. The president wants it to, and we want it to.
Yes. I know they want to, but I have heard nothing from President Moon or your party about the need to change the concentrated power in presidency.
No. We agree. And the President Moon might, I think he agrees too, that we take some powers from the president and give it to the National Assembly. That's the consensus. I think maybe President Moon said something about that. But anyway, I know that we want to give more power to the National Assembly and less power to the president. That's the very reason we try to amend the constitution. Yes.
Sir? You mentioned that in your 4 points enabling this change, the availability of a second party to step in and take over. Mm-hmm. So this is really quite relevant to the United States, mm-hmm. because we have a duopoly party system here. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, I appreciate your comments. Supposing we live in a system where the two parties are so similar, is Korea a multi-party state, whereas the United States is not really a multi-party state? That's my point.
Well, we are a multi-party state, but the problem is, in Korea, I think that's same in US too. Many people think that no political party represent him. So more than 40% of Koreans think that there is no political party for him. That's the problem. And so we are trying to represent as many people as possible with our party or the Conservative Party. So it answers your question. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm just curious about your personal thoughts and experience. You mentioned that, I mean, in retrospect, looking at your presentation, 8-0 vote by the Constitution Court, and the number of votes that went far above 200 at the National Assembly seems like it's a very, almost an easy process that happened, but you mentioned there were also backup plans on the day of the vote in case that failed. I mean, you are convincing very polarized ruling party to vote in favor of the impeachment. Also, the fact that the turnover was 8-0 at the Constitutional Court with all the conservative judges. What, in your mind, during the process, was there a doubt? Were you anticipating such a result? To the day-to-day process, I mean, how did it happen to this?
There was much doubt and talks about conspiracy. You know, we have 9 constitutional court justices, and they have only limited 6-year term, not like your Supreme Court justices who enjoy lifetime tenure. And at the time of the impeachment, several justices' term were about to be expired. And we need 6 votes to impeach the president, to remove the president. Not 2/3, 6 votes. So if one of the justices retired, it gets harder to impeach the president. So President Park did everything to delay the trial. And we were very worried. The Chief Justice retired, and the acting Chief Justice, one with the hair roller on her hair, 3 days before her retirement, they reached the decision. And so there are many concerns, but how can I put it? And the people's will was so intense. So if I think people made it. You know. Yes.
So maybe it's a different case, but whenever I watch TV and I see like Ivanka Trump and Jared Kushner, you know, like in the son-in-law of Donald Trump, president, and I just recall like the special relationship in between like President Park and Chesenship. So I think that there's many similarities, you know, these two relationships, you know. So I feel like the only differences between like these two cases are the first Donald Trump, the government, they just kind of like in public they just use them, you know. Hey, I'm going to use them, you know, for my tools, you know, because I trust them and I believe them, you know, something like that. So like, for example, like a Pyeongchang Winter Olympic, like Ivanka Trump was there in Korea, and then she had like a special meeting with the President Moon, and then they were discussing many serious topics, you know. But in other hand, like President Park, hide Sun Xiuqie, the shadow cabinet. So many people were shocked when it's exposed. You know, so like, I think that's the only difference. So my question is like, if President Park appointed Sun Xiuqie for give her like some official role, then it would be like maybe with my idea, like maybe President Park could avoid the impeachment. You know?
Yes. that's hypothetical, but the difference between Trump's government and Park's government was Park didn't appoint Choi Soon-sil for any official position. You You just criticized Donald Trump for because he used his. Okay, you were saying about them, but we could not say about Choi Soon-sil because we cannot be sure. Later, we found out that Ms. Choi went to the Blue House, Korean presidential office, at least one or twice a week. But if we say anything about that, the President Park's government threatened us to sue us for defamation. She very clearly said that she had nothing with Choi Soon-sil. So that's big mistake. But if he appointed Choi Soon-sil for some position, we could have criticized President Park for that. So. Yes, but that's not. I don't think that's for the that's the ground for impeachment.
Yes. Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation.
Thank you, Dean.
I am very interested in learning more. What are your thoughts concerning the mobilization of the population? So, who helped that mobilization? How that mobilization happened? You know, you said that it started in different places for many days until this huge demonstration. But what would you say were the factors that allowed that massive mobilization of the population?
There are activists in Korea. 시민단체가 뭐죠? Civic groups. And famous singers came out to the square and they sang. So it was like a festival. So we enjoyed that. And activists did their part, and we at the square during the demonstration we donated money, so to enable the next demonstration. It costs some money, so yeah, everybody chips in.
Yeah. Maybe I think the time is running out, so we got one more question. Randy Prince, program director of the City Club of Eugene. Well,
thank you. and once a protester in the United States, and I remember back in the time of President Park, how strong the KCIA, the secret police, were. Also, we heard of the Iranians, and they would monitor people everywhere. So, such a position of power. In the United States, we had a similar problem with the FBI, a program like the COINTELPRO. Even when the administration changed from Nixon and to others, and the courts said your activities are illegal, many of these disruptions of protests, legal protests, would continue. And today, still, activists assume that there will be problems, disruptions by police undercover agents. How did the police agencies go from the position of during Park to now, when the people were allowed to express themselves?
Hard question. we are reviewing what they were doing during the Park regime, and we bring charges to people who are responsible. So that way we can change the police and KCIA and things like that. And we want to reform them. And most people think that we need to do that. So things are not bad these days. Thank you.
On that note, he deserves a big round of applause.
Thank you very much.